Are you considering applying for global entry and weighing the pros and cons? Well, in this video, we're going to be taking a look at one under-discussed perk, as well as a couple of potential drawbacks to be aware of. Hey everyone, this is Kyle from Money at 30. On this channel, we look at personal finance from a millennial perspective, including travel tip videos like this one. A few months back, I made a video chronicling the benefits of global entry and my experiences using it. Since then, I've continued to find the service to be a lifesaver, even discovering an extra perk. At the same time, I've heard from others who have noted some issues currently impacting the program that I think are worth mentioning. With that, let's look at some lesser-known pros and cons of global entry and TSA PreCheck. We'll start things off with a less talked about global entry perk, which is the ability to use the Nexus lane when returning from Canada by car. While most people likely associate global entry with airports, it's also been expanding to select cruise line ports. On top of that, as I learned on a relatively recent road trip to Toronto, the program includes a major benefit for land crossings as well. If you dive into the CBP's site, you'll find mention that global entry members can utilize the Nexus lane when returning to the US from Canada. That might sound straightforward enough, but in practice it can be a bit more confusing since there is no mention of global entry on any of the signs, only Nexus. Considering that the regular lane was backed up all the way over the bridge into Michigan, I'd be lying if I said I wasn't a bit nervous when taking this seemingly huge shortcut. But once we reached the window, we showed our global entry cards, answered a couple of questions, and we were on our way. After passing the checkpoint, our arrival ETA on our phone's map dropped by an hour. Again, this perk is only available when re-entering the US from Canada and is not valid on the way into Canada. And, as I alluded to, you will need to have your global entry card with you in addition to your passport. As for some of the hidden downsides, due to a backlog and because there are fewer global entry interview locations than TSA PreCheck ones, you may find it difficult to find a reservation slot in your area. When I did my original review of global entry, I noted that my application took a few weeks to receive conditional approval and wondered if that was a long time. Well, as it turns out, I actually got pretty lucky. That's because, due in part to the month-long federal government shutdown in late 2018 into early 2019, the CBP has apparently been very backed up on applications. Not only does this mean longer waits for approvals, but also means a lack of available interview times after that. One friend of mine in LA said there were originally no interview times for him anywhere on the West Coast, but he eventually was able to snag an interview down in San Diego. Ironically, in this case, he didn't even really need the global entry and was mostly just seeking the TSA PreCheck benefits. Although this is mostly anecdotal, it does seem that the wait to receive global entry status is growing and that you might need to drive further to get an interview, unless of course you could take advantage of the program's interview on arrival program when returning from an international trip. For those reasons, if you're one of those torn between TSA PreCheck and spending the extra $15 for global entry, this may be something to consider. Finally, another note regarding TSA PreCheck is that not all airports will have their PreCheck lanes open at all times of the day. It's hard to overstate just how much I love TSA PreCheck and how much it's helped ease my stress when arriving at the airport. In fact, you could say that these experiences have spoiled me. That's why it's been frustrating to find that not all TSA checkpoints have PreCheck lanes available. For example, I learned that Atlanta's Hartsfield-Jackson Airport only offers TSA PreCheck during certain hours. But perhaps the most egregious to me is that, while the South Satellite Terminal of SeaTac's employment of global entry has proven extremely useful, the checkpoint that follows doesn't offer TSA PreCheck. Because of this, I recommend being prepared in the event you do need to go through normal security, such as having your 311 liquids accessible and ready to take out. And while it is annoying to encounter these pre-checklist examples, at least I can say that the vast majority of domestic airports I've flown in don't pose any issues. In other words, I wouldn't let this deter you from joining the program. With all that considered, I do still continue to love global entry and would recommend it if you have an international trip in your 5-year future. As someone who travels abroad at least a couple of times a year, global entry has proven incredibly useful for me. In fact, there have already been times that have made me wonder if I would have made my connecting flight had I not been a member of the service. Therefore, I'd say it's definitely worth it if you expect to leave the country anytime soon. Hopefully this gives you a better idea about some of the lesser known aspects of global entry, but for the basics and benefits, I'll have a link to my article on moneyat30.com in the description box down below. Also, if you like this video, please hit the thumbs up button, leave a comment, and be sure to subscribe because we have new videos every week. So thanks again for watching, and I will see you next time here on Money at 30.